Hello and welcome to the seventh video of the SBT framework series. In this video, we're going to take up where we left off at the end of the last video, looking at object-oriented programming, methods and properties. And we're going to use that today to expand our component that we created in the fifth video, our flow controller. Let's get started. So as a quick recap, you'll remember we looked at the reason that we actually use cyclic logic. We call our objects via a method rather than via the function block body. And the main reason for that was because that's how object-oriented programming works. It doesn't have these function block bodies. We just use methods. And therefore, to call something cyclically, we've implemented a cyclic method. And that's all we've done up to this point. So what we're going to do now is we're going to expand our flow control class to include some methods and properties to give it functionality and data beyond that to allow us to actually create a useful component going forward. So one of the first things we're going to do is give it a property. We're going to give it a piece of data, an identifying value about itself that is unique to the flow controller that makes sense given its operation. Now, if you imagine the scenario we thought up, our component represents a flow controller. So it's just going to be effectively something measuring a flow rate, which we used a simple counter for previously. And then we would effectively control maybe a valve or something based on that counter's value. So one of the important things we might want to include in this would be a maximum or minimum flow rate that we could impose on our object when we create that instance of the class. Okay, so you might imagine a scenario where we have multiple different instances of this class, this flow controller, for different hydraulic systems. Maybe a pneumatic system would be an interesting one. But they have different flow rates, etc., that we need to maintain. Okay, so we'd want to actually be able to adjust limits, as it will, for your high and low flow rate per instance or per object. So to add this, what we're going to do is we're going to add a max flow rate to our system. And very simply, all you do is you right click on the flow control class and add a property. And once you've done that, it will open up a declaration window similar to the POU one, but with the information necessary to create a property in TwinCat. So the first thing we're going to define is a name, and it's fairly straightforward in this situation. We're just going to call it max flow rate, and our type is going to be a real value. So we have to enter real in the type and then click open. And once you've done that, you'll notice it opens up that property. You can see it's appeared underneath the flow control class now. And there's a set and a get. Now, these two things are important. They are what we refer to as access methods. Okay, so they are ways in which we can either set the property of the class or retrieve the data. So if we call the get, then we'll be able to grab the information from the class and bring it out. And if we call the set, then we're actually going to give it the information. So there might be some situations where you have properties that you don't want to be able to change. And in those scenarios, all we do is delete the setup, but we'll see that later on in the video series. So all we're going to do is open up the setter. And what we're going to do is basically just create a local variable, which we're going to call underscore max flow rate. And we're going to set that equal to the name of our property. Okay. And once you've done that, you'll see the auto declare. Again, remember that you need to set it to the scope of the class, not to the local method, otherwise it won't do us any good. And that effectively then becomes a locked piece of data inside your class. So the underscore flow rate is something that is essentially a secret piece of information we've encapsulated away inside our class, and we can control access to it with this set and get. Okay. So if we want to impose rules on it, we could do. We could impose limits on what we actually are able to set it to. So we could say, for example, that they can't set it above 10 or below 0. We could do that in code here in the setter. If we double click on the getter now, then all we need to do is set the property colon equals the underscore max flow rate. And all that's going to do is when we call the get, it will then pass the internal value out. And we can then see what the value is set to in our main program. Okay. Now, once we've done that, we can actually already use this. So we can go into our main program. And all I need to do here is type flow controller dot. And you can see that I can then either call or access that property from the program now. So we could then write our changes. The next thing I'm going to do is quickly add a method to our system to give our components some more functionality. Okay, so this time what we're going to do is right click on your class, your flow control, and add a method. Now we're just going to do a very simple method. We're going to calculate the flow rate effectively. So what we'd really do in this scenario is count up the number of counts that have happened in the last time period and output a flow rate value per second, for example. Okay, so here just change the name to calc flow rate, and our return type is going to be an LREAL, and then click open. Okay, so in the body of this method, what we're going to do is very simply, we're going to take the current counter value and we're going to divide it by 10 milliseconds. So we're going to assume that we've already jumped ahead in our timeline and we've got the counter is actually reading from a real counter on a terminal, and it's going to be giving us not just an increase of one every cycle, but it's going to be giving us random values depending on what the actual count is in the intervening 10 milliseconds. We'll make a couple of changes to the iCounter in the cyclic logic to give us a bit more of a realistic value later on. But for now, all I'm going to do is multiply this by 100 because the cycle rate of my PLC is 10 milliseconds. So this is the count per 10 milliseconds. So multiply by 100 gives us the count across a second. And once we've done that, that's the method complete. All we need to do is call the method name, which is calc flow rate, and set that equal to the value that we calculate. And that will then return this, so we're actually getting a value back, okay? And again, just like the property, that means it's already available in the main. So we can jump back to our main, and we can find a create a variable called flow rate of type LREAL, and we can set that equal to the return value of the method, which we call by typing flow control dot, just like the cycle logic one, dot calc flow rate, open close brackets, semicolon, and we can see that value coming out. Okay, so I can now log in and you'll be able to see some of this working. Okay, so the first one, obviously the counter is now going up, so that flow rate value is actually just going to be increasing over time, the same as the counter rate is going up. We haven't made a change to the property yet, so if we log back out, I can simply set the property to, let's say, 1200, log back in, and now if we go inside the flow control class, you can see that underscore max limit is set to 1200. Okay, so we could apply this now to that calculation or to the iCounter to actually just reset it to give us a constant value. Okay, thank you for listening to this video. In this one, we looked at extending our component to include functionality and properties of our class. You can see now how you could build up a component to include more and more material, more and more functionality, more and more data. What we're going to look at in the next video is we're going to take this class and we're going to add some more functionality and use more of the structure that's already embedded in the component base. So we're going to look at the fact that it includes busy and done flags and busy and error flags for us, and how we would use those in a command pattern to actually issue commands to our component. Thank you.